I challenge you to come and see if this isn't real. I challenge you to come and bring those that are sick and afflicted and watch God do it. It's not me. It's not the people in here. It's the environment of Christ being in our midst. He's the healer. And there's nothing impossible with God if you can just believe. You know, when you think about a mother, some have good experiences and some have bad. But there's one thing about it. If you've ever had a mother that believes in God and prays, you got a gold mine. You got a jewel. And Pam Perez back here had posted a picture of her mother, Pina. And she was a class act. She never had an unkind word about nobody. She didn't sit and listen to gossip, and she never repeated something that wasn't worth being repeated. And what I remember from her was her kindness. Pam's grandmother and all of them used to come up to the church in Delaware, and I had a massage parlor up there. We'd go to the kitchen, and they'd have coffee and a little snack and stuff, and there was three ladies. And they couldn't wait till I got there to give them a back massage. They never paid me. They just bought my coffee. That's all I got. But Pina would make me a peanut butter pie. And it was so good. If one speck of that pie got on your forehead, your tongue would slap your brains getting at it. It was that good. And you know, when somebody leaves us and departs and goes on, the only thing that we have left is memories. And I remember my pastor down on Williams Road singing that song, Memories. And he would walk up to each individual. And the memories that we communicated back and forth over the years. It's very hard for me to talk about my pastor because I loved him so much. He was a spiritual mentor. And he helped me in so many ways. Excuse me. He would rebuke me so many times, I felt like crawling under the asphalt. And he would let it fly, and he didn't care if it hurt my feelings. But you know, in the long run, it made me a stronger person. And when you have somebody in your life, whether it's a mother, a friend, or whatever, and they depart, we don't like to see them go. But all you can do is remember the good times. Not the bad, but the good times. Because the good times will always outweigh the bad. Thank you, Mark. Thank you. And I was sitting at my table. I don't even know what I was doing. I was looking for something. And I had my Bible open. And God let my eyes fall upon a scripture. And I guess that's what I want to talk about today. Every one of us in here should be what we call a believer. Some more than others because you have experienced more of God's power in your life. Or healings or miracles or blessings or whatever you want to claim that belongs to you because of him. And a lot of times we overlook the small things. And the Lord led me here a while back to talk about some things and preach on them. And that was decree, command, authority, things of that nature that helps us be able to take God's word and allow it to be a force in our life to take over or overcome anything that might be facing you. We have no way of controlling death. Death is something that is assured for one way or another we're going to die. But are we going to be ready when we die? That's the main thing. unless you're lucky enough or blessed enough, let's put it that way, to make the rapture when it comes, and it's soon to happen. We don't realize how close it is. But I want you to pay attention to one thing that's in the Bible. It says, when they say peace and safety, suddenly comes what?
Destruction.
And they are working so hard right now to be building what they call peace in the Middle East. But suddenly there's going to come a destruction. If I had a cage down here, and it had a rattlesnake in it, and it was deadly poison, nobody in their right mind would stick their hand in there and try to pick it up. Because they know that if he bit, chances are they could die. But if you pulled those fangs from that snake, all it has is a gum to bite. It can't hurt you. But people would still fear it. And if you looked down in there and you saw that snake, you would still wonder whether it would or would not kill you. They went and gave these Iranians $150 billion. And that $150 billion is funding terrorists all around over there. Different groups, ISIS and several others. It was a bad deal because, let me tell you, you could say, I'm not going to build a nuclear warhead, but give me $150 billion. You don't have to build them. You can buy them. Hello? Common sense tells you that. There's nobody over there that likes Israel except America. We are like this. And because we are like this, we are blessed. Because the Bible very plainly says in Genesis, they that bless you, I will bless them. And that's the reason why we are blessed today, is because we do bless Israel. We are planning on having a revival coming up pretty soon, a tent revival. I'm still trying to figure out what they're going to do on their end down there. I know what I'm wanting to do. And Dave has given us permission to have that facility again this year. And I am very, very, very grateful for it because it blessed a lot of people. And I guess Dave will have to put them signs up and say R.W. Shambach. And we even put Catherine Kuhlman in there and a few others. And see who drops in to see them. I got a kick out of that. But I appreciate Dave's heart because he was so excited about having a revival on his property. He put these billboard signs up, and I mean billboards, 8 by 4 foot, all the way up and down both sides of the highway, and people were coming by and stopping in and asking when Oral Roberts was going to be there, all kinds of stuff. But it got their attention. And when God used me down there to pray for people, 90% of the people that God allowed me to pray for, as a result of the signs, showed up. Wasn't anybody doing any advertising, the signs did it for us. And I believe that in these latter days that we're in, and we're getting to where it's very, very hard to even preach the gospel anymore because you got people warring against you. They don't want it. It's too loud a noise and so forth. I was in San Diego, and E. Daniel Ponce told me to go find a place we could put a tent up. And we went out on this one corner. It's a four-lane highway on both directions, all four directions. But it was a big lot in this one corner. And there was this black lady. She was walking up and down the sidewalk, and she was speaking in tongues. She'd get to the corner, and then she'd take off and go this way, and then she'd go down about 100 yards, and then she'd turn around and come back and so forth. So we pulled up there and stopped her on the corner and said, ma'am, could you tell us who owns this lot? She said, no, I don't know. I said, well, we're wanting to have a tent revival here. Well, she went ballistic. She come 2 feet off the ground, screaming and shouting, running down the street, praising God. She already got her prayer answered, and we hadn't even got there yet. Well, we turned around and found out who owned the lot, and her name was Mrs. Ford, and she lived up in San Francisco. So I contacted her, and I said, Mrs. Ford, I said, my name is Bob Freire, and I'm down here in San Diego, and we're down here on, I can't remember the street, but I said, we would like to put a tent up down here. And she said, well, what's the tent for? I said, we're going to have a revival. She said, well, you just go right ahead, honey. You just set your tent up and go right ahead. I said, well, we can't do that. I said, we have to at least negotiate a deal, and we have to give you something for it. She said, sign a paper, send me a dollar. Have your tent revival.
Amen.
There wasn't anybody within 500 yards, a house, anywhere near that spot. But believe it or not, people were complaining about the noise that we were having there. And these two Assembly of God or Church of God men pulled up in a car with the police department. And I was told to go down there and get everything ready before they got there that night. And this Barney Fife woman comes up there. She's got her coat back like this, and she's got her pistol out here with her hand on it, thinking she's it. And she said, you, come here. I just looked at her, and she said, I said, you, come here. I said, you talking to me? I said, I ain't your slave. You come here if you want to talk to me. She said, did you hear what I said? Did you hear what I said? I mean, we had a discussion. Well, this other guy comes in. He said, sir, you're going to have to turn down the noise tonight. I said, what noise are you talking about? He said, that noise you're making out there. He said, you're disturbing people. We're getting complaints. I said, there ain't nobody complaining except them two demons right there, them preachers. I said, they're the ones that's complaining. And them guys jumped in their car and took off smoking gravel across that lot and left. We wound up having a 6-week revival there. And I mean, we had church. You see, anytime we're going to do something that we have intentions to do something good, evil is present. It's there to hinder you no matter what it is. And we have to learn, you can't fight the devil with your fists. It's like swatting at the wind. You can't fight God. They're spirits. And there's just as many evil spirits in the land as there is good. There's as many devil angels as there is God's angels. We're in a battle, warfare. When I first, God started dealing with me down in Woodsfield, I got very, very angry with God. I got mad at God several times. I cussed him out and everything, shook my fist and all kinds of stuff, but it didn't make no difference because he didn't pay no attention to me. I'm just a bag of wind. But when I was down there, I said, God, I said, I'm sick and tired of being a pawn. That's a chess game, if you understand what a pawn is. I said, you're up there on your throne, and the devil's up there, and you two are sitting down here watching us do whatever we're doing, and we make mistakes and get punished for them. I said, I'm sick and tired of this. And I learned that God was trying to teach me how to believe in Him and how to trust Him. And He allowed me to have certain things almost happen to me to let me know that His hand was upon me. One of those is my ex-girlfriend, brother, and I were cutting down locust trees to make locust post. And we would do it at nighttime, and we'd lay the trees where they'd fall up the bank, and then we'd drag them up the top and cut them in the road and throw the limbs back over the hill. But in the daytime, I went down there. I figured I'm going to go down there and cut me some more trees down because now I can see better. And I'll never forget this as long as I live. I had one hand. I was pretty stout then. One hand, I had this chainsaw, and I was trying to cut this limb, and I went like this, and it went right through. It was so sharp, it went right through the limb and went right straight across my foot. I thought my foot just got cut off. I looked down, didn't see no blood. I was petrified. I took my boot, and I could take my boot and go like this. It cut nothing but the leather, and did not get my foot. And that's exactly what I did. I thank God. That was a sign that God let me know He's up there watching over me. Then one night, we're trying to haul these great big boards from a pole barn. It was probably 18 inches wide, 2 inches thick, and 20 foot long in the back of a pickup truck. And I come down, I'm driving, I'm coming down this valley, and I'm trying to get back up this hill, and I get stuck. And I thought, well, what I'm going to do is I'm going to just back up as fast as I can, and I'm going to fly up this hill. Well, I wasn't thinking about that board sticking out the back of my truck. And I backed that truck up about 25 mile an hour and slammed into the bank, and that board came up and smacked this frame around my face, which if it had been an inch over, it would have broke my neck. It would have hit me right in the side of the face and killed me instantly. That was another sign. Now, I wonder how many times you can look back over your life and remember when the hand of God was there watching over you, that something really bad could have happened but didn't. Did you ever stop to thank God? Does it bring back memories to know that God was there all the time, waiting patiently in line? Did you ever stop to think that if you wanted to war with the devil, why do you go to one of your neighbor friends or somebody else and ask their opinion, instead of going to the Word of God and using the Word of God in your defense? Hello? Because that's the only thing that Satan's going to listen to. You can sit there and cuss and fuss and carry on and rebuke and do all that stuff. It ain't going to do you a bit of good, because, see, he don't hear that. But what he does hear, he hears the Word of God. So I want you to turn with me. I'm going to try to get through this if I can. Psalms 35, verse 4. Here's how you can pray when people are warring against you. When they're trying to take your house, they're trying to steal your joy, rob you of your salvation, take away all of your possessions, whatever they're trying to do that's got you so bound up and scared that you don't know where to turn and you don't really know how to pray. There's some things that you just don't know what to say. So you have to learn how to use God's word in your defense. In Psalms 35, verse 4, it says, let them, that means whoever's coming at you, be confounded and put to shame, that seek after your soul, my soul, it says. Let them be turned back and brought to confusion, that devises my hurt. Whenever you're sitting at home and everything seems like I don't have enough money to pay my bills, my landlord's threatened to throw me out, I got this stolen from me, I got that stolen from me, my best friend lied on me, my best friend cheated on me, and so forth, and you go on. You're sitting there and you're confounded with words that you can't even pronounce or defend yourself, because you don't know what to say. And notice what this prayer was. This was the psalmist's. He said, let them. He didn't name them. He said, let them, whoever they are, be confounded. And then he said, let them what? Be confused. You know, when you're sitting there in all chaos and all pain and hurt and whatever you want to call it's there, all you have to do is bow your head and say, God, this is out of my control. I'm asking you, God, to allow them to be confused. I'm asking you, God, to block. In other words, you take your authority. Comes back to the words I was trying to teach you a few weeks ago or a month ago. Take your authority in God's word. Your word that come out of your mouth is powerful and strong. You can say this day, even though it's raining out, it's snowing out, it's freezing out, whatever it is, this day is going to be a blessed day for me. The words that come out of your mouth makes it happen. Amen. Or you can sit there and whine and cry and carry on, and it ain't going to do you a bit of good. In Psalms 40, verse 14 and 15, he says, let them be ashamed. To be ashamed. See, they don't care about you. The devil don't care about you. Confounded, together that seek after your soul, my soul, it says, to destroy it. Did you ever notice that when you first got saved, if you really got the salvation that you're supposed to have got, man, you were so happy you could climb onto the housetops. You were so happy you just couldn't wait to tell somebody what happened. But immediately, the devil comes and tries to steal that. If I pray for somebody today and God heals them, before you get to your car door, the devil's going to be on your tail trying to steal your blessing. Did you hear me? That's how you have to learn. When he comes in like a flood, what does God say he will do? He will raise up a standard. And that standard is to defend you because you are precious in the sight of God. He died for you and I. He paid a marvelous, awesome price for you and I that we may have what? Life. And may have it what? Abundantly. It goes on to say, let them be driven backward and put to shame that wish me evil. Let them be desolate for a reward of their shame that say unto me, Allah, Allah. Not Allah, but Allah. I might not be pronouncing why, so I'll spell it. A-H-Y. A-H-A. Aha. 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 They're laughing, that's right. Psalms 34:5. I sought the Lord, and he heard me, and delivered me from all of my fears. When fear grips your heart and you get nervous and you automatically, the devil's going to tell you, hey, when you go to court, the judge is going to throw away the key. You got to remember he's your lawyer. He's the author and the finisher of your faith. He's the beginning and the ending of all. And no matter what the devil says or throws your way, you're going to be an overcomer, because when you walk through the gates of heaven, if you make it in there and he says, thy good and faithful servant, enter in, guess what? You won. Amen. If you read Revelations, the end of the book, you won. We've won. Amen. All we have to learn how to do is endure and keep our faith and not give up. Because if you give up, you'll never know what you missed. I have a friend of mine, a lot of you know him, a lot of you don't, Mrs. Davis' son, Tony. Last time I went over to visit them, we were talking. He said, Brother Bob, he said, you ain't gonna believe this. He said, God gave me the numbers for the winning lotto, and I went back to sleep and didn't play them. And it was over $1 million. Now, some of you would condemn that and say, that's not right, gambling. Well, if I had all the money I spent on Dr. Pepper that did no good for me, that $1 that I put down and won $1 million was a lot worth more. I could do a lot more with that money. Amen. Some of you send you to hell because you went and gambled. Yeah. Reverend Jenkins got him. God gave him the numbers. He asked June Buckingham, go down here and get this ticket for me. The reason he didn't want to, he didn't want somebody to see him buy them tickets. And June says, honey, I'm in my nightgown, I'm ready for bed, and I'm not going nowhere. June, I got the winning number. She said, honey, no, have John do it when he gets there. So John Gardner shows up. He said, hey, John, I want you to run down there and put these numbers on this ticket. He said, God gave me this number. He said, no, he said, I don't want to do that. Here, I bought two tickets. You can have one. He said, I don't want that one. I want this one. God told me this is a winning number. Well, come around the time, I don't know, it was 11 o'clock, 6 o'clock, whenever they read the drawings. Rev was sitting there on the TV, and they called these numbers one by one. And the closer they got to the end, he's getting real excited. And all of a sudden, it hit the lotto number, and it was his. And he got so excited, his blood shot out of his nose. He got so excited, but he forgot that John or June didn't go get the ticket. And it was more than a million. It was several million. But see, some of the holier-than-thou preachers would have sent him to hell if he went down there and bought that ticket and won. But see, knowing my pastor like I know him, he would give 99% of that away. I've seen him do that. I've seen him give diamond rings that was worth thousands of dollars, cars. I've seen him buy a home for people and put them in it. See, you got to learn how to overcome skepticism. I got people that criticize me the way I dress. Ask me if I care. I don't give a flip. If this is going to send you to hell, man, you're on your way. Because it ain't doing nothing for me. It's making me look good, that's all. Y'all sit there in your little parlor in your bathroom and powder your face and eyebrows and put your lipstick on and fix, ooh, that hair's got to tuck it in, and oh, this dress, and you come to church looking all holier than thou and got a Dairy Queen hat of hair and sleeves hanging over your hands and dress dragging your feet, and your tongue can slap that door handle back there. You're trying to adorn the outer appearance instead of the inside. It's what's in that comes out. As a man thinketh, so is he. And the heart is what God wants right. If the heart's right, you'll treat people right. If that heart's right, you'll go around doing good for people instead of evil. Do you know what? Every time you see somebody that committed a crime, a horrible crime,